This big river has been dictating Egypt's fate for thousands of years. It lets life grow at its banks. Our journey along the Nile leads us to the origins of a great civilization that never ceased to amaze until today. The people who live at its banks say that the Nile is the band that unites and connects Egypt. Near Aswan, the granite rocks of the first cataract build a natural barrier. From here on, the river is navigable until its mouth. These women are walking to the banks of the Nile to baptize a baby. The procession looks like a scene from the Old Testament, when little Moses was abducted on the Nile in a wicker basket and saved by the Pharaoh's daughter. The choir of the relatives chants, "Great God, please allow him to grow up." The noise is supposed to keep all evil away so that the child can grow up without disturbance. The women belong to the ethnical group of the Nubians. Traditionally, these families settled near the border with Sudan, but they were expelled when the Aswan High Dam was built. The Nubians are devout Muslims, but many of their rites remind us of pre-Islamic times. Their tradition demands that a miniature ship be sent on its way during a baptism. It symbolizes the newborn and its way in life. The mother's intercessions accompany the little ship on its journey.
Almighty God, please keep all people who could do him harm away from him.
Our big journey down the river starts in Aswan. We travel from the Nile island of Elephantine to the camel market in Darrow and on to Luxor with its famous temples and the Valley of the Kings. Near Amarna in Middle Egypt, the locals proudly preserve their traditions, and Egypt's Garden of Eden is located at the Fayum Oasis. The river turns into a delta after Cairo and enters the Mediterranean Sea after 6,853 kilometers. One of the biggest bird migration routes leads through the valley of the Nile. Near Aswan, six of the Nile Islands are classified as nature reserves.
My name is Atiyat Karayib, and I work as an ornithologist at the nature reserve south of Aswan. I love birds also because of their colors. They're both beautiful and valuable. There are ibises over there.
Aswan is an important resting place for migratory birds. The ornithologists count them as they pass here on their way to their winter quarters further down south. But Atiyat and her assistant are concerned. The banks of the Nile are unusually empty. Will there be less migratory birds arriving in Aswan this year? Local herons are the sole inhabitants of the cataract's rocks. The environmentalists claim that migrating storks from Europe were shot in large numbers. Environmentalists barely dare to step on the officially protected Nile Islands. Atiyat's team was threatened by poachers too. The scientists carefully choose their path. They don't want to startle the birds. But they are mainly concerned about a confrontation with humans. During the revolution and the following political turmoil, some of the land at the protected areas was illegally occupied, and the city of Aswan's growth is out of control ever since.
Unfortunately, the migrating birds meet many obstacles here. When they come to Aswan, the natural habitats that used to be here are gone now. There is a harbor and other human interference at the banks of the river. And the places where the birds could find food are gone.
The farmers on this island also refuse to give up their land again. Bad news for Atiyat and her feathered fosterlings. The biggest Nile island near Aswan is called Elephantine. During the times of the pharaohs, it was a flourishing trade and garrison town with an international flair. Elephantine was the perfect junction for passenger and goods traffic. Only the old cataract hotel gained fame in modern times, thanks to the screen adaptation of Agatha Christie's Death on the Nile. Elephantine greets its visitors with the pharaoh's insignia. Today, archaeologist Cornelius von Pilgrim researches the vestiges of the past. For a long time, this region was the southern border of the pharaoh's empire, and the Nilometer is one of the oldest structures here.
This Nilometer was important to predict and record the Nile's water level throughout the seasons. It was especially crucial here in Aswan, where the Nile enters the Egyptian mainland.
The pharaoh's tax collectors determined the farmers' dues depending on the inundation of the Nile. This is how Queen Hatshepsut was able to finance her monumental temple dedicated to the goddess Satet and herself.
The inundation of the Nile was ritually celebrated here at the temple, for the public as well. The water was filled in some sort of neck and flowed through a groove to the big celebration yard that was accessible for the regular people. They were able to get there via the main road. They watched the water rise and were allowed to drink and collect it.
The island's name, Elephantine, means ivory or elephant, and it refers to the town's former significance as a trade post for tusks that were imported into Egypt from Sudan. The town flourished thanks to this trade. Further up north, a sandstorm is rising. The camels already feel it coming. Huck Hussein wants to drive his animals over the river to the market before it starts. The ferry traffic is halted during a storm. Hussein is in a hurry. He chases his driver. It always takes a lot of time for all passengers and vehicles to embark. Cruise ships have the right of way on the Nile, which means that the ferryman needs to use the gaps and step on it when required. But there's rarely as much traffic as today. The decline in tourism means a compulsory break for many passenger ships. They mastered the greatest obstacle on their way to the market. Luckily, the sandstorm remains on the other side of the river. Darrow's market is legendary. Already more than 1,000 years ago, camels were traded here. Haq Hussein safely arrived with his animals. Twice a week, he and his nephew Mohammed throw themselves into the fray. Haq Hussein enjoys the atmosphere that has barely changed since his childhood.
This market is the biggest in the whole of Egypt. The animals are distributed from here to the rest of the country, to Asyut, Cairo, Aswan, Minya. You can find everything here.
The camel's teeth provide an insight into their well-being. Hussein is an expert in camel assessment.
It won't take more than 2 months for this sort of camel to be at slaughter age. They're clean and healthy.
Many camels are sold as animals for slaughter, but the more precious ones are treated as riding animals and status symbols. Hussein also likes to invest in the animal's outfit so that his premium stock makes an exceptional impression on his clients. The animal barely resists. It doesn't even mind the eyelash cosmetics. Long lashes are eye catchers. The beauty treatment is worth it.
We shear the camels in order to get rid of dust, bugs, or dirt. Once the fur is gone, the clients can judge the camel's weight. They usually weigh between 300 and 400 kilograms.
Donkeys are treated with a visit to the hairdressers too. This animal must have lived through this procedure already countless times.
We also shear this donkey's fur so that it looks clean and pretty. It adorns the rider too, as it says in the Quran.
The triangle supposedly protects from bad luck.
I learned this profession from my father, same as all my ancestors before him. This profession is handed down from generation to generation, and we can make a living from it.
Pleasure before business. Buyer meets seller. One man wants to get a good deal. The other wants to achieve a good price. Off they go.
Our camel train from Sudan takes 40 days to the Egyptian border on foot. And from there, it's only 3 or 4 additional days.
The tone becomes more aggressive. The negotiations aren't easy. The situation suddenly seems to run out of control. They shove each other around. Their tone is harsh and brusque. The mediator shouts at them repeatedly, but the two opponents don't react. A brawl seems imminent.
You're a crook. I swear by God, I never buy 2 camels. One is my maximum. Get out of the way. I'll take this camel.
The buyer vigorously proceeds to action and separates his desired camel from the herd. But the transaction still seems to be in the balance. Again, the mediator needs to step in for further negotiation. The observer on the sidelines is glad that the conflict doesn't escalate, as some of the men here carry concealed weapons. But the insiders know that this is just a well-rehearsed ritual that is part of each decent camel sale. And it's celebrated on each market day like this. It's a tradition. So this transaction comes to a conclusion too. After the exhausting market day, the men relax at the tea house and pay their dues.
I love the market because it provides for all of us.
Even among friends, it's common courtesy to count the money. Unlike in Europe, it's considered impolite if you don't count it.
There are more than 4,000 sellers at this market. You get everything you want. Camels, calves, donkeys or sheep, everything.
For traders and clients alike, the market is their highlight of the week. They meet old friends, exchange the latest gossip, and arrange marriages. And they can smoke their shishas, filled with a stimulating tobacco mixture, in peace. After market close, Hak Hussein buys meat for lunch at the camel butcher's. He prefers his wife and daughters to stay at home. Hussein likes to do grocery shopping by himself. Camel meat is considered a delicacy and is healthy too. It's lean and low in cholesterol. The butcher is a close relative. Therefore, there's always time for some family gossip. At Hussein's house, the women already await the groceries. No man who isn't part of the closer family circle is allowed here. And the household activities of the man of the house abruptly end here. The women reign at home. Hussein's sister and his daughters prepare the meal for today's feast. The lady of the house doesn't show as long as there are strangers in the kitchen area.
You boil water and add the meat with salt, spices, and onions. You let it cook until it's tender and fry it for a short time in the end. That's it.
The house has a special reception area where visitors are kept separated from the women. The first guest to arrive today is Imad Musa, a shipowner from Luxor. He's looking for a berth for his ship when he needs to spend the night around here. River navigation at night is forbidden on the Nile due to many shoals.
I'm doing fine. I was at the market today. It all went well.
Even though everyone here knows the reason for this visit, it isn't mentioned for quite a while. They ask each other about their family's well-being and exchange news. After the first cup of tea, it's the right time for negotiation regarding the anchoring berth on Hussein's territory. In the kitchen, there's a strict hierarchy too. The oldest daughter is in command as long as the mother isn't there. Even roasting the camel meat is a matter for the boss. Camel meat and beef are brought to the table, as well as cooked aubergines, tagine from the oven with okra and tomatoes. Hummus and tahini are mandatory side dishes. Beside the visitor from Luxor, there are also two dignitaries from the village. Some of the plates aren't touched. The guests know that they are only put there symbolically. They're removed later. It's the food for the women, who always eat after the men are finished. Haq Hussein's wealth neither shows in his modest clothing nor his lifestyle. What matters to him more is the respect people show towards him. Only a drive through the family's vast plantations gives an impression of his true property situation. All over the country, Hussein is praised as the mango king, both due to the quality and quantity of his produce. At the plantation, Hussein also cares for his little pet zoo. It's one of his hobbies. The menagerie reminds a bit of biblical times, when Prophet Isa was born in a stable, as devout Muslim Hussein calls Jesus Christ. The main mango harvest is done. Mohammed is looking for late bloomers that shall provide seedlings for new mango trees in the local nursery. Hussein's mangoes are sold all over the country. Whoever owns enough land near the Nile is a rich man. The river delivers all required water to the doorstep for free. The harvest at this plantation averages between 50 and 60 tons of mangoes per year.
The best quality is taken to Alexandria for export.
He's doing great. Hussein is only worried about the new bridge over the Nile. Oil has been discovered in the desert nearby.
Of course, the bridge will be of use for people on both sides of the river. The land has always been very fertile and we'll still be able to use it when the bridge will be built. We'll see. I've been living here since I was 12 or 13. When I was a child, the water level was higher. The water went up to here back then, but then it dropped steadily, and now it only reaches that palm tree over there.
Hussein always has the river in his mind. The Nile formed people's fate in the Nile Valley until today. It's said about life and rivers that everything flows. At the tourism center in Luxor, many people quickly gained a fortune from all the visitors. They became more dependent on them than on the Nile. The balloonists from Luxor start their day at 4 o'clock in the morning At that time, it's still icy cold on the edge of the desert. But their work has become a routine during the past few years. Mohammed Musa is wide awake and alert. Every little mistake can result in disaster when you want to get airborne. The heated air lifts the balloon. One heavy gush of wind, and the ground crew would have to fear for their lives.
I always dreamed about owning my own ballooning company. I've been working hard all my life until I achieved it. Now I own my own hot air balloons. It took me 13 years to get there.
This morning, mainly Chinese and Egyptians booked a flight.
You only get a license for the foundation of a ballooning company if you followed all rules and regulations. Security regulations for air traffic are very strict in Egypt. I persevered and passed everything until I got my license.
Mohammed has cursed his decision several times already when other balloons collided in the air or their gas bottles exploded. There were fatal accidents. Mohammed also couldn't sleep well due to his worries when political turmoil caused less and less tourists to visit Luxor. The higher the sun rises, the more it heats up the air, causing turbulence. Then the balloons cannot be steered anymore, which is why they only start in still air or when there is only very little wind. The morning breeze drives the balloon in the direction of the Valley of the Kings, where many rulers of ancient Egypt are buried. The mortuary temple of Pharaoh Ramses is almost within reach. In the east, the sun rises over the fields. The smoke of burning cane fields colors the morning air above the Nile. The Sahara spreads out behind the rocks with the pharaoh's graves. From here on, it's nothing but 4,000 kilometers of desert to Morocco. The bird perspective shows the former reach of the yearly inundation of the Nile. Settlements were only built behind that area. Agricultural life still works similar to many millennia ago. Many farmers must have been glad that the pharaoh's tax collectors couldn't count the crop yield and the livestock from above, too. Shortly before the landing, there's a problem. The wind turns and drives the balloon in the direction of the planted fields. It needs to land. But it all goes well. Almost every family alongside the river is dependent on tourism. During the political crisis, they prayed that the number of visitors would rise again soon. The Ragab family's oldest daughter, Senap, was forced to move in with her parents again. Shortly after the birth of a baby girl, her husband left her, out of disappointment that she didn't bring a son into the world. But he refused to get divorced, and only with a divorce certificate would Senab be eligible for receiving social benefits.
Now add the yeast.
Today, mother and daughter are baking the traditional sun bread.
Slowly.
Living together in such a confined space isn't always easy.
We put the dough in the fridge. If we like to bake bread in 2 weeks, we take it out on the previous evening and add some water and simply bake it. The small bread is for my daughter.
Senab's biggest worry is that, as a single mother, she would be a burden to her family. The rays of the sun help speed up the dough's fermentation process. Then it's time to fire up the oven. Mother Shifa has declared this her exclusive task. The writing on the oven says, "In God's name, so that the bake shall succeed." The dough needs to have the right consistency, hard on the outside and soft on the inside.
I'm dead tired. During the past days, I had to do it all by myself.
The baking process leaves enough time to prepare the food. Grandma peels the garlic, and her granddaughter does her homework. Farha's life is very different from that of the other women in her family at her age. She wants to become a doctor and build a big house near the Nile. Wants to know what her granddaughter's drawing.
I'm drawing the Nile because its water is better than any other water in the world. Therefore, nobody shall throw any rubbish in.
Right beside the house is the onion field. Even though it's springtime and it's not very hot, the field needs to be watered daily. With Nile water, of course. The locals couldn't imagine that this amount of water could one day not be available anymore. Here, you already learn about irrigation technique as a child. Onions are a staple food for the peasant population. Now, it's time. They need to be quick. The bread's only baked for 5 minutes in this heat.
Are they ready?
In a minute.
We've got 2 bread sizes today.
First, Farha's small bread needs to be taken out of the oven. It's hot.
We eat this bread with everything and don't need to buy any. It replaces rice or noodles, and it stays fresh in the fridge for up to 20 days. It only needs to be heated.
The yard is also the family's living room. The carpet is for eating and praying on. All the garden produce is brought to the table. Spinach, leeks, rice and onions. This lures other inhabitants to the table as well. The pigeon is unaware that it might land in the same pot one day. Senab doesn't want to depend on her relatives all the time. She did an apprenticeship as a seamstress at a welfare facility that is sponsored by donations.
It needs to be black, not white.
In the meantime, Senab also started to train women who are also dependent on an income of their own, like her.
Divorced women are treated as sinners here. They aren't supposed to leave their house or go to work. But I do both and have been working here for 7 years now. Karima, you can do that at home as well. I've been working here for 3 months now, and I learned embroidery and other things. After the training, I want to work from home because of my children. I hope that this will help me in the future.
For Senab and her trainees, the workshop is the chance of their lives. Their self-made bags fill them with self-confidence.
My name is Karima, and I made this. I'm Adila, and this is my bag. My name is Senab, and I created this. This is the oven and the sun breads, just like at home.
Gamal Latif bought a canvas in town and he's on his way back to the village where he lives. When Lake Nasib was flooded in the 1960s, 50,000 Nubians had to leave their villages. Gamal's family was among those displaced. They found a new home further down the river. Gamal's main purpose in life is preserving Nubian culture.
I didn't study art or have any education in regards to painting. The trigger for all this was my oldest daughter's wedding. Our tradition says that we need to paint our house with white chalk for that occasion, but I didn't like that. So I decided to paint it colorfully, in our traditional style. I bought colors, and that's how it all started 2 years ago. I bought some wood panels and painted on them. My first painting is there on the wall. I'm quite proud of it.
Gamal's paintings tell the stories of Nubian everyday life, like about the language of the Aldabahas, the door locks.
If the lock is pulled out, it means the owners are at home. If it's in the middle, it means they will be back shortly. And if it's closed completely, it means nobody's home and they won't return for a while. You only need to look at the lock in order to know this.
Everyday life in Upper Egypt is shaped mainly by Islam. Following the religious commandments, prayers and frequent visits to the mosque are essential for Gamal too. But the Nubian traditions contain much older rituals. Gamal's son puts his hand in red paint. In the old days, they used animal blood. The so-called hand of Fatima shall ward off the evil eye. This protective magical symbol dates back to the pre-Islamic folk religion. Most towns along the Nile were founded during the times of the pharaohs. Nakada has existed for 5,000 years too. Many Coptic Christians live here. Adel Habashi's family has been dealing with woven fabrics for as long as he can remember. Some of the female weavers are recognizable as Copts, not only because of the images of saints on the wall, because those women aren't afraid to open their mouths in public. This is quite unusual in the Egyptian provincial regions. The thermometer has risen up to more than 40 degrees Celsius. Every movement is exhausting now.
I started to learn weaving when I was 15 years old. My grandfather painted fabrics and worked on the loom. My sister worked from home, and she taught me how to weave. My father also painted fabrics. Our family has been doing this work for a very long time.
We exclusively sell these shawls to tourists in Hurghada, Luxor, and Sharm el-Sheikh.
The survival of the weavers in Nakada depends on tourism. An uncertain future in times of crisis. Karun Lake is a natural wonder. In the middle of the Egyptian desert, water emerges from the deep, fed by the Nile. The great river brings life to the inhospitable Sahara. The fishermen don't mind where the water originates from. The high salinity also allows sea dwellers like soles or prawns to thrive. And those fishing are happy about that, no matter if they use a boat or wings for the catch, like this kingfisher. Even more than 9,000 years ago, fishermen cast their nets and fishhooks here, as archaeological finds documented. But the water now has become saltier than in the sea. The freshwater animals are dying out. But Karun Lake is still a little paradise in the middle of the desert. The Fayum Oasis only exists because of this water. It's Egypt's Garden of Eden. But the desert belt of sand and stone around the oasis is getting tighter and tighter. These rocks used to be the seabed, remains of the Tethys Ocean that covered this land 40 million years ago. Erosion wears away the sandstone, but petrified sea dwellers bear witness to the dramatic changes of the past. Today, every living thing seems to have gone from here. But some have specialized in adapting to this deserted land. For Mansour Talba, the desert is the perfect workplace. It has been feeding his family for as long as he can remember. Mansour invited his son to join him on a very special training outside so that this know-how will be passed on to the next generation. Humans usually avoid encountering the animals that live hidden under these rocks. Mansour earns a lot of money from catching them. In order to survive his workday, he needs to be very careful.
Take the scorpion. I first remove the poison so that you can touch it. Then it's not dangerous anymore. You think you can catch scorpions on your own now? Okay, now you saw how to remove the poison and catch them. But remember, you need to grab them by the tail. That's their weak spot. Now you can lift it up. Look at the sand around its den. When scorpions build their den, they pile up the sand like this. This is how you can find them. Understand?
Karim's exciting lesson isn't over yet. The family business deals with another desert animal that requires even more caution.
I'll now teach you how to catch snakes, as this is our profession. My grandfather taught it to my father taught me, and now it's your turn. You need to grab the cobra from behind its head. It's very dangerous and poisonous. As it's such a dangerous snake, we need to press its head down and grab it from behind. Once again, in order to catch it and to be safe, you always need to grab it from behind its head. Do you like it?
What do we do with the cobra?
We take it to the snake farm and sell its poison.
The Bar Yusuf, the waterway of Joseph, connects the Fayum oasis with the Nile. Further up north, the river changes its shape and turns into a delta. For thousands of years, Cairo, Egypt's capital, has been located here. All around the metropolis, villas bear witness to its former glory as remains of an era where sultans and pashas ruled the land. Cairo the Strong, Cairo the Conquerous. The biggest city in the Arab world bears many colorful names, but it's in danger of being suffocated by its size. 20 million people live here. Basma El Gabri leads Egypt's first motor scooter club for women to the Lion's Den, the historical center of this moloch. Basma prepares the scooter riders for confrontations, but most of the club members only dare to hit the streets as a group. It's a real dare for the young women, and only few club members joined today. They were attacked several times from out of car windows. But on this public holiday, the women finally decided to do this adventure ride from the outskirts of town to where the action is.
I usually don't get in trouble, not only because I'm a woman, but because I ride a motor scooter. I try to encourage the women because it's rather uncommon in Egypt for women to do that. Therefore, I established a blog called Girls Go Wheels, where the girls can chat and talk about their experiences.
Their destination is the traditional Kalili Bazaar. Many of the houses are 500 years old. This used to be the biggest bazaar in Africa. Especially the spice bazaar attracts a lot of people with its selection of oriental range of products. For their club's anniversary, the women are looking for choice ingredients and spices.
This is Egyptian salab from orchard root.
It's very sweet. Only the best, please. You've got no Wi-Fi here?
A client endlessly talked to his wife about what he was supposed to buy. In the end, it was just one little thing. Is that all?
That's it.
The young women are on their way back by daylight. They are proud because they mastered the big city traffic challenge. Behind Cairo lies the vast river delta. Now, the Nile flows slowly through the flat agricultural land. After 6,853 kilometers, the Nile enters the Mediterranean Sea. This is where our journey along the cradle of a great civilization ends.